Good morning. Welcome to Equity in the Edit Room. I'm Maggie Bowman. My pronouns are she, her. I am joining you from the ancestral land of the Potawatomi people here in Chicago. And for the visually impaired, I am a white woman with a red and white striped shirt, dark brown hair, sitting in front of a blue wall. And I am the interim director of programming and advocacy here at the IDA. Before we get started, I just want to thank our funders for making this event possible, which is the Los Angeles Department of Cultural Affairs, the Jonathan Logan Family Foundation, the MacArthur Foundation, and the Los Angeles County Department of Arts and Culture. We'll have our conversation, and towards the end, the last 15 minutes, we'll have a Q&A. So please use the Q&A function to share your questions with us, and we'll share them with the moderator. And during the Q&A portion, we will call on you and bring you on camera and microphone so you can ask your question in person. So for today's panel, I'm so excited to welcome you. This discussion has emerged over several months of dialogue with the editors Carla Gutierrez and David Teague on behalf of the BIPOC Doc Editors Database Project. And as with so many of the important discussions in the documentary field in recent years, this one is a story of volunteer-run grassroots filmmaker networks. Marjan Safinia of the Beyond Inclusion Working Group made sure that we knew what the BIPOC Doc Editors Database Project was working on earlier last year. We started in dialogue with Carla and David, and then their group joined forces with the Alliance of Documentary Editors. As they launch their database and other initiatives, they will be working with ADOC, the Black Documentary Collective, Across the Cut, Brown Girls Doc Mafia, the Documentary Producers Alliance, Queer Producers Network, the D Word, and a number of groups that have all sprung up in the field in the last several years to make the documentary field more inclusive, equitable, and economically sustainable. We are really thrilled to support the work of these groups however we can, and I'm so grateful for the partnership of Carla and David in developing today's panel. And now I'd like to turn it over to the esteemed editor, Maya Mumma, of the Karen Schmeer Editing Fellowship, which has been focused on supporting the craft of editing for the last decade, since 2010. Maya?
Hi, thank you, Maggie. I'm Maya Mumma. I'm the interim president of the Karen Schmeer Film Editing Fellowship. I'm a white woman with dark hair and a striped shirt with a gray background with artwork behind me. We're here to talk today about a new initiative within the Alliance of Documentary Editors, which is a database for BIPOC documentary editors of all skill levels, as well as an initiative to highlight the role of mentorship and growth within the documentary industry through the standardization of the role of the associate editor in the edit room, which is to address pipeline issues for BIPOC documentary editors. And today we have with us an amazing group of editors, producers, and directors. We have Faisal Azam, Hannah Choe, Carla Gutierrez, Kristi Jacobson, and Alisa Payne. And hopefully today is just the beginning of a lot more conversations about this. We have 90 minutes today, so I wanna get right to it once everybody gets here. And everybody's bios are pasted into the chat too, so you can read about everyone here. So hello, everyone. Here, okay, there we are. Everybody, Alisa, hello. So. I just want to go straight into this. So Carla, I want to talk about something that we had discussed that really sparked the idea of this initiative. I know this wasn't the beginning of you thinking about these issues, both in your own career as an editor and within the documentary industry, but there were some studies and statistics that had circulated around the documentary community that you read that really seemed to spark the the impetus to act, to really start to do something or figure out what we can start to do within the community to address these systemic issues. So can you tell us about those things that you learned?
Yeah, there were so many triggers and sparks this past year, besides the numbers that we were getting and the information that we were getting from our community. I can tell you one of the biggest triggers for us has been, you know, this kind of like open discussion that our field is having about inclusion and equity. And we want to make sure that, because we as editors feel that editors are such a crucial, you know, component and voice in the creative process, we wanted to make sure that we were, you know, a key part of the conversation, and that, you know, editors were not being left behind in this. And, you know, the numbers that we've seen lately really kind of reflect what we all know and what we all see in our community. When we go to festivals, when, you know, some of us are really lucky to get into the award season campaigns, you know, it's just very few people of color, editors of color in the room when you're in that space. And especially it's the pool of like very experienced editors, the editors that that are really sought after, that everybody calls for, you know, for the jobs. It's just not very inclusive at all. That pool of editors is very white, you know, just to be very blunt. And we also learned from an early survey that the Alliance of Documentary Editors did with their membership, is that, and one thing that really surprised me is that, yes, is our community is not very inclusive, but there is more diversity in the ranks of people doing assistant editing and associate editing, this emerging talent that is coming in. But what was very disheartening was to learn that we're losing that talent, because especially, you know, it's affecting BIPOC editors disproportionately, but people are just getting stuck in those positions and they're not having the opportunity to learn the craft. And we're just losing, you know, what could possibly be the next crop of amazing editors, and a pool that could be so much more diverse than what we have now. And that to me was kind of like a call for action. Like this, you know, we just can't be losing that amazing talent and those amazing storytellers and the, you know, those amazing voices. So that's what really, you know, brought us together to do this work. We are building from the amazing work that the Alliance of Documentary Editors have been doing to support each other, to create opportunities for, you know, for more diversity and more inclusion. But we also wanted to, you know, make this more of like a public effort to really engage with producers as to like what's happening here, to open up communications and really to put our faces and our talent out there. You know, the biggest kind of goal that we have is, you know, to work with producers so that they extend their networks. You know, documentary hiring happens very much, you know, people are just looking for personal recommendations. You hire who you know, and, you know, when our community has not been inclusive, then it's white creatives hiring other white creatives. And we just need to just look outside of, you know, what we know, what is close to us. So we decided to create this database, which we just launched. Is you can go find it at BIPOCDocEditors.com right now. And it's just been so amazing to see so many faces of, you know, editors at all levels of experience. People that I, you know, have not known. It's been great for me to see, you know, to see all that talent, and we're really excited about it. But also at the heart of what we're trying to do is this idea of protecting, you know, what we know creates great editors, which is mentorship in the workspace. You know, everybody that you know, like all the editors that you love and that you love to work with, you know, they were at some point somebody's assistant and at some point somebody's apprentice. And that's how they learned the craft. And we just don't want to lose that, you know, that learning, that apprenticeship that can happen, that can really open up the doors for just more fantastic storytellers. And we want that next generation to be a lot more diverse than what we have now. So that's, you know, kind of like the description of what our initiative is. I hope I didn't go too much on
tangent. No, it's great. That's perfect. It's perfect. And I want to start kind of at the beginning of what your initiative addresses, which is that kind of broken length, a broken ladder, I think is a word that you use a lot, from people rising from the AE position to the editor seat. And I want to talk to one of those amazingly talented people who's been working through kind of that system, Hannah Choe. And Hannah, I want to ask you about your experience as an AE, how you found your way into the documentary space, and what challenges you've been faced over what has been a long career in the documentary editing world, especially in working to grow into that editor position.
So I went to film school originally to study narrative film, but I ended up taking a documentary for social justice class while I was there, and it's pretty much changed the entire course of my life. From there, I actually studied the work of this one filmmaker who's now become kind of like my film aunt and mentor, Deanne Borchet-Lim, who I've had this like long collaboration with. And actually from there, I met one of her former assistant editors who was becoming an emerging editor. And she actually got me into my first paid gig. And then she became like a really incredible resource to ask questions, because especially when starting out, things are really complicated and Google will only take you so far. I've been in this industry about 10 plus years. And the thing that I've been finding is that the AU role, at least for me, has become mostly a technical role. I mean, I think, digital workflows and deliverable packages are getting increasingly more and more complicated. There's so many different like cameras. Like if you're on an archival film, like it's even more complicated. There's oftentimes hundreds and hundreds of hours of footage, and I don't think resources and post-production timelines are scaling proportionally to match that. So oftentimes, especially during the pandemic, we're not even in the same physical space. My first AE gig was actually, I was working weekends and the editor was working weekdays, so we didn't even work the same hours. I think the technical role has kind of become an overtime position and doesn't leave a lot of room for creative growth. And maybe I would get, a first pass at a scene, but I don't get to do multiple versions, which one doesn't allow me to get better. And then two, I don't have a reel by the time I leave, so I can't actually find a way into editing positions. And that's actually been one of my biggest obstacles.
And Faisal, now someone who found their way into the editing chair and has had varied experiences working on lots of different types of productions, what have you observed in your own journey and in the edit rooms that you've been in about that dynamic between the editor and the AE? And I should mention that you and Hannah are working together, and we'll get into more of that too. But talk to us about that dynamic.
Sure. I should start by saying that actually my personal experience was really kind of out of the ordinary in terms of becoming an editor. I moved here around 2004 to New York, and I was changing careers, so I was starting a little bit later in my life to get into film what I wanted to do. And so when I came here, there were not the organizations that had been mentioned. The field looked very different. It was basically a group of editors who did narrative work, and very small group, and they got all that work. And then the rest of the people were kind of in docs and TV. And the amount of work was like so little compared to now. So I quickly, I got a job as an assistant on one project. And what I observed that, it was kind of like what Hannah's describing. And I saw that on that one project, it's like, I was working nights, I wasn't there with the editor. I was giving all these crappy tasks to do, some of which were just ridiculous. Like, oh, somebody did this little like 2 minute cut, but we lost it. So we need you to go through the footage and recreate it frame by frame. And I was like, just let me edit the thing. So I quickly noticed that this is a scenario, and that if I was gonna have to get to where I wanted to be, which is to be an editor, I couldn't spend 10 years of my life, because now I'm starting not at 22, but I'm starting at age 30. And so I just sort of was in the wilderness myself, because I knew I wouldn't get the mentorship and the help, and had to kind of carve out my own career, like starting in smaller films and experimental science fiction and corporate videos, and basically teaching and mentoring myself. So having gone through that and then becoming an editor, I, you know, everything I thought at the beginning was validated, because I would come on projects and they'd be like, well, here's your assistant, but you only get the assistant for this little bit of time at the front, and when they're going to do all this tech stuff, and then maybe they can help you if they have time between 50 million other things. So I started to see that, you know, I'd meet these assistants who clearly were ready to learn and wanted to learn. And I also wanted to mentor people, because I want to give people what I didn't have a chance to have, and I had to come up myself. So I would meet these people along the way, but I just wasn't able to help them because of time, lack of resources, et cetera, et cetera. You know, obviously if I was in a TV project, then I had a proper assistant who worked with me for a long period of time, and I could mentor that person, help bring them up. But definitely on the indie productions, it's much harder. So as I began to sort of notice this dynamic, I started kind of reaching a point where I would insist at the beginning of jobs, like, hey, you're gonna give me an assistant, so can we make sure there's enough time for the assistant and I to kind of work together, where I can mentor the assistant and the assistant can learn and get tasks that are beyond just the tech organizational stuff. And you know, it was really kind of starting to say that, you know, I realized that my role, like if this is ever gonna happen, I have to speak up as an editor and I have to say, this is something we need. And is it possible for you to make it happen? And, you know, when I bring it up to producers, I think it's a lot of times, it's just the kind of thing people have just not thought about. And so when I bring it up and I say, hey, is this possible? Then, you know, the response is more often than not, it's like, oh, let me look into it. Let me see what I can do. And, you know, that's how Hannah and Kristi and I started working together. We came on a short together, and then Netsanit, who's the producer, and Kristi were like, we're gonna get you an assistant. So they found Hannah through the Karen Schmeer Network, I believe. And we were both part of that. And then, you know, I said to Kristi at the beginning, I was like, is it possible to have Hannah overlap me a bit so that I can mentor and sort of, you know, help her learn more than just boring AE stuff? Because clearly she was coming into it with a lot of experience, was really good, was really excited to work and learn. And, you know, I just know that if you keep getting that same old thing, at some point you're gonna wanna quit because you're not learning. So that's sort of where I'm coming from.
And now you're working with Kristi. And Kristi, I'm curious, when Faisal brought this idea to you, how you as a director thought about it, from kind of most kind of on one side, the ability to even create and hire these positions, and also kind of what benefit did you see to the editing process and to the your actual potential film itself?
Yeah. Hi, everyone. I'm so happy to be here. And So I think there's a couple of things. I'm a director. I'm also a producer, and I have a small company. And I'm a white person who's committed to creating a more equitable and inclusive landscape here in our industry and beyond. And have been thinking about ways to be a part of that change. So when Faisal and Hannah were working together first, we were working on a pretty short doc with like a really tiny budget for with a grant. And we just kind of like established a relationship, and then during that time we got Netsanit Negusi, our producer, and I got another project that was an episode of a series with a more sizable budget. And, while I am trying to be intentional, I need to say that, like Faisal said, in order for me to work on this as the editor, I need for this to be the scenario, and we need to make this work. Hannah also said the same thing. We were all synced up on that, and then proceeded to try and create a schedule and a budget that involves Hannah being on the project the entire time, Now, at a rate that, you know, just some nuts and bolts, that is a fair assistant editor rate, right? But is there even an associate editor rate yet, right? But with the commitment to be on for the whole project, and so that we would create the space for Faisal to be in that role of mentorship. And mentorship, as someone noted, is like, I didn't get to where I got, which was directing my own films, without the mentorship of Barbara Koppel, who, you know, who took mentorship also, or like being a part of a mentorship scheme involves taking some risk. And, you know, streamers are risk averse. We know that, right? So like, you know, they want to know, well, why, or any, you know, produce, the higher ups want to know, well, I see an extra, you know, we only need an AE at the beginning to set up the project and at the end to create deliverables. Oh, the edit should be twice as fast if you've got two editors on it. At a certain point, I just decided within our project and within my company, I'm committed to this and we're gonna make it work. And the, you know, the goal is not that we're gonna cut it twice as fast. And to your point, Maya, at the beginning, the value of what is, you know, not only Faisal's experience mentoring Hannah's experience, and hopefully her next project being an editor, you know, not an associate editor or an assistant editor, or, you know, moving forward. And also these two perspectives, these two talents are now contributing to this film that's gonna go out into the world. So, you know, I think that we all, you know, again, I wanna note that Faisal said, this is how I work. And that was a motivator. And so for the editors here, you know, to like really kind of establish that. And then we'll talk later about what we as producers and directors can do to ensure that the answer is yes. We'll get into that more. Sorry, I'm like screaming maybe.
That was great. And I love like the, all of you all as a team also is just an incredible value, I think, today to have you all talking together too. Alisa, you had a project recently where you had an incredibly talented BIPOC AE who was able to kind of grow within her role. And I really want to find out from you about kind of how you as a producer created a team dynamic that allowed or gave space for people to thrive and grow. And if that's something, how you're looking to carry that forward into other projects, and are there challenges that you're foreseeing or experiencing because of our industry?
Yeah, so I want to say thank you all for having me here. I'm so honored to be on this, and I'm so glad to do my small part in this work. Congratulations to you all for doing this. And I am a Black woman with Black hair and a skunk streak of white hair in the front. And so for all of our friends who need to know. I had the distinct honor and pleasure of working on Between the World and Me, based on Ta-Nehisi Coates' book of the same name, and to produce a documentary film in 16 weeks from beginning and end to end from the day that I was hired. And so we joke about that being a wonderful pressure cooker of an experience. And I always said to my team, we were solidly in 2 weeks in, we were in pre-production, production, and post at the same time. Not to mention, we also were working in the pandemic, as we all know, this was last year. And so that meant that we had editors and AEs all over the US. We had people on the West Coast, we had people on the East Coast. We were shooting in six different locations, New York, Atlanta, Oakland, LA, DC, and in New Jersey. And so there had to be we had so much happening at once, and there was no other way. As a person, I'm very collaborative. And so as it was very important for me up front, and for our director, to make sure that we were getting for the film the full diasporic and diversity in the Black experience. And so then it makes no sense, then it could only make sense to then also have diversity and take all of the voices behind the scenes into account when doing this work. And as you mentioned, you know, we're doing a film in pandemic and having such a truncated timeline, 16 weeks from the day I was hired to get completely staffed up, completely crewed up, and then deliver the film for air 2 weeks later. you know, requires a lot of scrappiness, but it also allows a lot of allowed us a lot of creativity and, like I said, collaboration on different levels. And so there was a particular, when we would go out and shoot, there were celebrities whose homes we went to that had not even seen their family members. We had people who were not allowing others into their spaces and to trust us in that space. Though they were trusting us, we had a very short window of time to get it right. And so, as you know, if you have something that's done in production and it's not quite right, it is often the editor's job to problem solve along with the director and the producer to make sure that we have something that's usable. And in one case, we got some footage out of the, we got some footage that I just couldn't, and our senior editors really were having a difficult time troubleshooting. And, you know, me as a producer, I was kind of like, I think we're getting to the point where we just have to just abandon this and not use it. And our AE stepped up and said, you know, can I take a crack at it? And she took a crack at it. And not only did she take a crack at it, but she knocked it out of the park. And she came to it with this storytelling, like, magic that, you know, it was a combination of her talent and I think pixie dust that she sprayed. Because like I said, we had some really senior editors who just couldn't get the challenges. We had a team of four people who really couldn't. We were working and working and working at it. And as a producer, I was starting to not see the value in continuing to work on the scene. And when she did her magic on it, we got it not only to a point where we all could write notes about it and see how it fit into the beautiful tapestry that is that film, but I also realized, like, that if this had not happened, we would have missed this opportunity, not only this opportunity for this beautiful work in the film, but also this opportunity of having this young woman really flex her muscles. And, you know, I am a beneficiary of that. And so for moving forward on all of my films, I want to make sure that associate editors and we were, like I said, we started from the beginning wanting to include more voices. I'm a Black woman in this industry. You know, there have been many times when my voice was not allowed to be heard, right, as much as I would have wanted it to. And so as a producer, I give people full access to me. I love what everyone said about the editor speaking up, because I do think that sometimes you're in your bubble as a producer and you're not aware of what's happening, and you don't have, you know, in Zoom, I had an opportunity to see and interface with people on a regular basis because I was in home lockdown, and some of the shoots I couldn't go to because of restrictions on travel. And it gave me opportunities to get close with everybody and to be accessible to everyone. And I think that we have to figure out how to do that when we go back to the new normal of the world as we knew it. And producers and directors really have to buy into this. And, you know, the unfortunate part of that whole experience and what I talked about is that the only credit that was available to us at the time to give her was additional editing. And I wish, and I'm so happy and sublimely grateful that you all are leading the fight towards getting an associate editor position, an official position, because that would have been much more rewarding for her, I think. And the mentorship that you all are providing is going to be invaluable. And I just want to say that I'm also a consulting producer for 1619, and I forwarded your website for them so that they can look at different editors, because we were doing all of the things that had been said before. We call this person and we call that person. Do you know this person? And thankfully, it seems like the big names in BIPOC editors are working, but there has to be more people. There has to be that we just don't know about. And so for that reason and others, I'm so grateful that you all are doing this work. And I'm just proud to even be able to grow upon that work in my little ways.
Thank you for that. That's actually perfect. I was going to move back to the actual database itself. And I want to bring us back around to the idea that in order to create more equity inclusion in the edit room needs to be more reflective of our society, which means hiring from a much broader range of backgrounds and perspectives, which is something we can do through this database initiative. So Carla, can you just tell us about the database? It's not simply a database. I know there's a lot more on it. Can you talk to us about the construction of it, and I believe you have some slides to show us just to kind of get a sense of the scope of the website itself.
Yes, I love this because we're you know, opening the site wide. Like right now, we're telling people finally the address, but we know that some producers have used it already. So Alisa, so great to hear that. And keep checking because the database, it's growing every day.
We're yes, getting Carla, I'm telling people that. I'm telling them. Yeah. Like, they're adding people. Trust me. Keep looking.
Yeah. So yeah, let's show something. But it's, you know, we open it up for editors to create profiles. And editors, you know, out there, if you're not in our database, please come to visit us. You can create your profile, you can update it at any point after a one-time verification of your credits. It will go live. And look at these faces. I mean, this is our homepage, and the faces change every time somebody like jumps into our homepage. Let's go to another slide, see if here's our database. We are, you know, we really want this partnership with producers to really work. You know, we are providing a tool that you guys can use for your hiring. And we have been trying to think about ways that could make it easier for you to find people. So you can actually sort and search editors based on location and language. We're asking editors for demographic information as well. So, you know, here it is. I mean, sometimes what we hear from, you know, from production companies is like, yes, we're trying to find those people, but we just can't find them. So here's a tool that you guys can use now to find the talent. This is an example of a profile. And you know, there's a resume that editors can upload. Producers can even make a list of the editors that they're interested in contacting and export a spreadsheet of that. You can link to their work or their website and the IMDb page. And you know, this is just so that we really establish this partnership that we're looking for, you know, for producers. We have very experienced editors being part of our database. We also have people that are emerging, and the database is also open to editors that are just looking to break into the industry. So we have a filter that is for people, you know, looking for those entry-level positions. So this is how our database works, but we have also set up and share a set of guidelines in the way that, you know, production companies can think about, you know, how to be truly inclusive. Like, it's not only, you know, hiring that person maybe to fill a quota. You know, we editors sometimes get hired, you know, a little bit later in the process when maybe the production, you know, is making a sensitive film about one community, and they realize that, you know, they don't have any brown people in their team or any Black person in the team. So don't think only about us when you're trying to fill that quota, when you're trying to get that one face in your team, but think about it more, you know, holistically, like in terms of creating, you know, an inclusive, diverse team from beginning, from development to end. We're also asking producers not to pigeonhole BIPOC editors. You know, we could bring some sensitivities to specific stories, but please look at us as, you know, complete storytellers. We are expert in stories. We create worlds from, you know, hundreds of hours of footage. So we can tackle, you know, we can tackle any story, especially if the team is inclusive and diverse and has done the research. It's just that, you know, diversity of experience that you're bringing into the team is gonna make the project richer. So please, you know, visit our website, read our guidelines. You know, we have a basic guidelines about, you know, schedules, like don't overwork us. It doesn't make for better work. and we really want to, you know, sell these ideas to the streamers, to the big production companies, because we know that they have the budgets to provide for true mentorship. And, you know, we want to talk to them about how mentorship can actually really help their projects, how it can be organic to the creative process. We're asking streamers to consider adding an associate editor position in their projects, in their series, in the films, as an additional position that is a creative position that is thought of as a way to jump to lead editor at some point. There seems to be, to me, I don't know about other people, but to me, there seems to be a shortage of experienced editors right now. Everybody seems to be booked. So I think that there's an opportunity, if we do this mentorship right, to just widen the pool of great storytellers. The time is right now, and why not do it so that we create more diversity for our films? So that's something that, you know, we are engaging with big production companies and streamers about, and we want partners on this. I think that's it for me.
Yeah. Now, a lot of what you said is, I want to open this up to everyone here to join in the discussion of this too. There's been a lot of growth in the documentary industry. There are a lot more jobs out there. We've all seen the industry change, especially over the last 10 years, I think. But yet we hear, you know, there's no one to hire, everyone's booked. I remember through the Alliance of Documentary Editors job posting site, there was this posting, people were looking for AEs, and it was like the headline was like the great AE shortage of 2019 or early 2020. And there are people out there, but at the same time, there are a group of people who are perhaps looked to first, who are booked. And I just wanna talk about whether they're kind of how we can start to tackle this within the idea of kind of the networks that people tend to work in, and also the idea of the kind of the pipeline as well. Why are we hearing that there's no one to hire, and what are some things that we can kind of do to find the best people we can to hire for projects?
Well, I will tell you that what I had been doing was reaching out to every single person, and I mean everyone, turning over every stone, trying to, you know, because sometimes you also hear that we hired the best person, we hired the best people. And I'm like, well, how do you make that determination if you haven't been in contact with so many people? Thankfully now with this database, I won't have to do that, at least for editors anymore. But, you know, for every position, I've been very intentional on all of my film work to really contact the usual suspects, but also the people who are not, and mostly the people who are not, right? And to be very specific, even with agents, a lot of times agents come and they pitch their people, even in doc editing, they'll pitch their people and say, hey, I have this wonderful person. And then you'll say, well, do you have any BIPOC people? And then they'll say, oh, I don't really, but, and then they'll say, well, if you know of anyone, feel free to put them, you know, point them in my direction. And I think for every person that I found out about, if they were not available, I would get three other recommendations for every, you know, and then I would contact those people. And like I said, luckily it seems like a lot of editors are working, so that's good. But I think there's so many other options if we keep plugging away at it. And now if we use this database and we encourage all the editors and AEs we know to sign up on it, I think that the job and the task will be easier. And then also we just need a buy-in, right? So we need buy-ins from editors that are senior editors that are here to say, like, listen, this needs to change. That's really important, because we need the buy-in from them to also mentor, because there would not be this crop of new editors unless people are willing to mentor them. We need a buy-in from producers and the people who can move around the money. We need the buy-in from directors to understand that these voices are also important, right? And then, like you said, we need the buy-in from the streamers, the networks, the studios, et cetera. And that's where we all have to like put pressure on it as producers and all of us in the industry to try to make that happen. You know, recently I had an experience where I was trying to get an associate editor on a job, and I thought that this particular company would buy into that. And then I realized it wasn't really going that direction. And I had to decide, well, can I rework my budget to make it work? And it takes that type of commitment, I think, to actually show that you're willing to do this, despite the fact that you're getting rejected by the streamer or the studio or, you know, the production company. And I think we all need to be intentional about the work. And it seems like Faisal and Kristi, and we know Carla and David Teague, who has me, who I had the pleasure of working with on Between the World and Me, and you, Maya, are all doing, and Hannah are all doing the work. And I think we just need to make sure all of our peers are doing the work all the time, even when no one's watching.
Yeah, I would add to that that, you know, sometimes we're only looking for editors that have that one credit, you know, that festival. And you know, I hope that streamers also won't put roadblocks into the hiring. I mean, in the past, I hope that's changing, but in the past, streamers and distributors, you know, would approve the editors. You know, they might have to be, those editors might have to had worked for that streamer before. So, you know, look at the work of people, look at their films. You know, there are those mid-career editors that, you know, who are doing beautiful, beautiful work. Look at their stories, and they might just not be getting as many calls as, you know, the last kind of like editing award at Sundance, right, from last year. So really make the effort to extend that network to get to know as many people as possible, and not only, you know, call that one person that you know, or that one film that, you know, got all the accolades last year, that editor. So that's, you know, that's one way to do it. And again, you know, I hear Hannah talk about like the limitations of like being stuck with only technical work, and the pressures of only doing that work. And I think that, again, that's a lost opportunity. You know, we know what kind of mentorship works, and that's something that we're also adding to our website. You know, we know that if you bring your assistant editor, your associate editor into the room where the creative conversations are happening, where you're talking about structure, where you're talking about narrative arc, you know, you are preparing that young editor to be ready to tackle a scene, because they're gonna know what that scene needs to do in the big picture of the story, right? So we also want to set them for success. Like, you know, like again, Hannah mentioned that like maybe she would get a chance to only edit one scene, but then she wouldn't get a chance to like be able to, you know, revise that scene, get feedback. And that's how the learning happens. So yeah, we want to change that culture, because I feel like that culture and that understanding has been lost throughout the years. So that there's buy-in from production companies and producers, that they understand that that type of mentorship is also gonna help them finish the film, right? If that person understands the story, they can help during crash time to, you know, to create really great scenes for the film. It's gonna keep your film on schedule, it's gonna keep your film on budget, you know? That kind of relationship can allow the directors and producers to maybe experiment with some, you know, narrative ideas, because they have this associate editor, this assistant editor that can jump in and try new things. And, you know, like Alisa said, look, that revelation that assistant editor really like was able to do something that other people were having a hard time with. So, you know, those are the things that just make the films richer. Those are the things that you know, can help you get to the finish line with your film. So we are asking for that buyout from all levels of production, from the streamers, for the people that are financing, you know, to the people that have those hiring powers.
And on the like note of the buy-in, Alisa mentioned, you know, like, there's buy-in at various levels, and there's change that needs to happen at various levels, but senior editors, in particular, senior white male editors, have a lot of power. They're at the top of all of these networks' lists. So anyone who's here, like, you have the power, you're in demand, you can come to the table and say, I'm gonna do this project if, you know, I've got the time and space to do this mentorship with, which Faisal, you know, again, did say. And I just want to note that there's these few top editors that have this power and they can be using it. And, you know, I think that oftentimes in conversations around equity, you know, white folks can get like caught up in this scarcity zero-sum game mentality. And, you know, this lifts all the boats. So I think it's really important to think like that. And also, we're talking about a pipeline that needs to be fuller, right? And this does not mean let's go to the database white production companies when you have a film or a series that is about minority or marginalized people. This is about a database of talent, of talented young, emerging, veteran editors who are also people of color. And I think like that's just something that like needs to stop. We need to move into this other place. And then I just wanted to like actually pass it back to Faisal and Hannah, because Faisal, you had spoken about this in our prep call, but like the importance of an editor, being able to articulate why something didn't work, why they're doing this instead of that, is it's partly intuitive, and young editors might have that intuition, but it's also learned. And so I thought maybe you two could talk about how you're working together to maybe help people who are here to kind of see that a little bit, even though I know the database is also delineating that. Just because, you know, having editors who also know how to push back or move their ideas forward in spaces where also they might be minority, you know, white rooms with white execs. Let's talk about that.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I think we all know that editors are storytellers. And, you know, during the process of production and budgeting and the whole grind of filmmaking, sometimes that's forgotten, right? Editors are hired to come on board to help to make the story, to figure out the structure, to figure out what's the best way to tell it, to look through this enormous amount of material and figure out what are the best shots I can use and how can I put them together most effectively to tell the story, to elicit emotion, to do what film does so magically. So, you know, with that in mind, I feel like the storytelling is what should be taught in a mentorship situation. That's like one of two things. I feel like a lot of assistants coming up, they get the technical stuff down. And then where there are not opportunities to grow and learn that, they get stuck in the level of skills they develop. So if you only ever get that one scene and you only ever get to do a first pass on the scene, how would you develop beyond the very rough version of that to what a polished version looks like? How would you develop beyond that to how does this scene work in a sequence? How does it work in the overall flow of the film? How do you adjust the length of it based upon all those other factors once you've kind of got it to a certain level? So because editing is a craft and storytelling is a craft, it has to be learnt in a craft-like way. And the way you do that is by actually doing it. Not having the opportunity to edit never makes you a better editor. It's just because you're not doing it. Like most things in life require actual doing. You can read the theory, you can study it, but unless you're doing it, you're not really actually learning it. The second way is to actually be mentored or work with somebody who's experienced, who can distill like years of knowledge for you into an absorbable size, and also understand how to kind of like instruct along the way to help you get the skills when you need them. So that, to me, that's like the two parts of one side of what mentorship is about, that the editor is hopefully bringing for the associate, or in whatever field mentorship occurs, you know, you're passing these skills on. And once the skills are acquired, then obviously the magic comes and the art comes, but the acquisition of skills takes a while. The second part that's really key in mentorship that Kristi, you mentioned, is learning how to present ideas, learning how to interface with directors and producers, sometimes executives, with all kinds of people, learning to participate in sometimes screenings where you have a lot of people and you're doing public screening and you're having all these questions and thoughts thrown at you. So a lot of assistants who are coming up really are hired for this very specific thing, which is technical, as we've talked about. And they're really not visible. They're not seen beyond, oh, that's a person that was hired to like take this stuff and ingest it and get it ready for the editor. And so they usually don't feel confident or even feel like A, that they're visible, and B, that they have a voice that anyone's listening to. So the most important part in mentorship on the personal side is to basically help the person coming from that situation and to transition and learn through observing and participating. How do you have meetings? How do you interface with the director? How do you interface with producers? How do you take their challenging ideas sometimes? How do you deal with network notes, which we all know can be very challenging and difficult? And how do you navigate and negotiate that? And then how do you also make sure that the good ideas in the process are first, you know, accepted from wherever they might come? Because they can come from anywhere. I believe that I don't have the best ideas in the room, but I go with like wherever the best ideas are, right? Sometimes they're my ideas, sometimes they're Christy's ideas, sometimes Hannah's, sometimes somebody from the network has a bunch of notes we don't like, but and there's one note where you're like, oh, that actually makes it better. Let me take that. So you have to learn this process of how do you filter all those notes? And then you have to also learn like here are the things that are sort of protected in this, or I'm trying to protect, like here are good ideas that we worked on and the story that we've crafted that we know is the best way to tell it. So how do you then have a way that you can assert yourself and assert ideas when needed and be able to adjust the back and flow of all of that? So that's something that someone who just comes from assisting cannot do that immediately and may take years for that person to kind of figure out how to do it. But if you're in a situation where the three of us are, where we're in meetings, every meeting we have, Hannah's part of it with Kristi and with Nitsanit. And we're all four of us are there. And so creating the opportunity and the space for Hannah to, in the beginning, just observe. And I encourage her, you know, at the beginning, like just chime in if you have thoughts or whatever it is. And then as we sort of went along, you know, Hannah was more quiet in the beginning, but as she gained more confidence and saw how to do this, she naturally just started participating more. And soon I will not have to do these meetings and Hannah will just take over, so.
I'm gonna piggyback off of some of this too. Cause I think, one thing I want to do that might be beyond the scope of this conversation, but I think we really need to talk about culture of a workplace, because like, I think from all the BIPOC colleagues and friends that I know, kind of the biggest roadblocks have been places where it's not safe for us. Essentially, like what Faisal is talking about, I think the reason that I've been allowed to thrive in the situation is because they've created a very nurturing, safe space for me to actually thrive and succeed, which is really critical for especially somebody in my position, because a lot of what I'm learning to do is build confidence to like hone my intuitions and to explore creatively. Because I think, unfortunately, there is a lot of, you know, toxic unchecked behavior in our industry, because I don't think there are currently systems of accountability in place. And that's kind of been actually like the number one reason that I've seen people leave the industry. Because I guess the thing I'm wrestling with sometimes is I think creating access to a space for BIPOC is important, but it's also, I don't want them to be in conditions where they're gonna be exploited, overworked, mistreated. So I think that that's really a critical question that we as an industry kind of collectively need to take responsibility for and have bigger conversations about this. And then another thing that I think Carla was mentioning before is like the intentional creation of an associate role in addition to the assistant, because I think right now sometimes projects like they make associate roles extracurricular, so it's on top of your already overtime workload, and I think that really sets people up to fail in this industry because they're burned out, like their physical health suffers. And I think I guess those were like the, so I'm like always a big advocate of 8-hour reasonable work days, because I think also, sure, bigger editors can advocate for you, but I've worked with a lot of incredible, amazing editors who I have really great relationships with, but they haven't had that power and they're overworked and burned out too. So they actually haven't had the ability to mentor in the ways that I know that they want to as well. So,
yeah, thanks for saying that, Hannah. I think one of my biggest responsibilities as a producer, and I urge all the producers on this call here too, is to create that environment that you were talking about, right? So, you know, we, as a producer, I'm very keen that I have to create a certain experience for my director. And I like to say that I create a bubble for my director so that he or she is able to create and not be interrupted by all of the noise and the things that happen. And I take all the feedback from the network, and I take a lot of the other meetings that he or she doesn't need to be involved with so that we can be focused on what they're there to do. But it's also really important that producers and directors to create the environment that you're talking about, right? Because on the production, we are the main contacts, we are the main supervisors, we are all of it. And so it's really important that we take responsibility and are really intentional about the workspaces and also get feedback. You know, a big part of it is checking in, right? I'm trying to get Maya on my next project. And we talked about Maya, fingers crossed. And we talked about the fact that I still, in COVID, I want to be remote because I still want to be safe, even though we're moving towards a new normal. And Maya asked me a really great question. She said, well, you know, how are we going to like make sure that everyone feels included? And I said, well, it's my model to make sure that I check in weekly with every department, but that I also have regular check-ins with every member on the team, as well as the overall meeting. And I think that that's so important. And we have to take responsibilities as producers and directors, the lead creatives and lead logistics people, to make sure that we're establishing a culture that people feel included and valued in, but also protected, right? We all spend more time working more than generally when we're on these projects and with our family members and friends. And so I like to create a family, and I think it can only benefit you if you really have this relationship with all of your people. And I don't understand people who don't feel that way. I wanted to just say, Kristi, you took my two notes. Zero sum game, and that it benefits everyone to make sure that BIPOC people, women, all, you know, queer people are hired and bring their different individual perspectives to all projects, right? I don't consider myself to be a Black producer. I saw something with Shonda Rhimes, and she said, one day I would not be a Black female showrunner. I'll just be a showrunner. And I think that we all bring our individual experiences. I like to tell people I was meant to be a producer because I was I'm the oldest of three girls. And so I was accustomed to like managing and creating, you know, producing my life. And so we have all of these unique experiences that we can bring to any project. And I just want to encourage all of the producers and the people who can greenlight projects to look at this database and see all of the possibilities for all of your projects, because we all have these experiences, this know-how, this storytelling, this expertise, and the heart to tell these great stories. And there's no limit.
I'll just like to add to what Hannah was talking about, which, you know, I think that's incredibly important, like what happens after you do the hiring, and what is the work culture that you're in. I, you know, just want to give a big shout out to the ADE. We are creating there with Alliance and our partnership with Karen Schmeer too. I feel like we're creating solidarity among editors to tackle these issues. So if you're an editor out there, please go to the ADE website, become a member. That's what we're working towards, to like have all these pieces working together, to, you know, end result again, make beautiful films that we're all proud of. So that's, you know, we're bringing all of our leverage, what Kristi said. You know, I mean, one of the things that has really personally trigger me is a speech by Louis Erskine that he gave at Sundance. And he said, you know, if you're in the room, you have to be a disruptor. And that's how I feel. Like, I've gotten access as a woman of color, as an experienced editor of color, and it's on me, my responsibility to use that leverage to, you know, to be able to lift up other BIPOC editors. So I think that we all need to do that as editors, as, you know, as producers, production companies, streamers. So yes, thank you for bringing that up, Hannah. That's incredibly important.
And on the disruptor note, I just want to point everyone to BIPOC Makers and the BIPOC Makers Twitter, which is a group called Beyond Inclusion, that's fighting for, you know, ecosystem-wide change. And I think to your point, like, I feel like, you know, we're fighting for, and to Hannah's point about the how long the day is, like, we're fighting for a more equitable working environment, right? Where not only are people seen and heard, but their time is valued and respected, and we understand, you know, all those things. Our industry, the doc world has obviously changed a lot. I think, again, the onus is at all of us at each of the levels to, you know, kind of demand the amount of weeks that are needed for the edit to not kill the edit team. We don't always have that power, but when we do, we should use it. And those who do, flex it. Maybe some of the streamers are here watching and participating. I hope they are. But like, you know, many have made, you know, verbal public commitments to more equitable spaces and anti-racism and these kinds of things. So there are real tangible ways, you know, that beginning from the grassroots and in these offices and right on up to those decisions about where and how this funding is allocated. So let's just hold everyone's feet to the fire and work together here.
Can I make one last point, which yes. is, you know, we are talking with our associate editor initiative. We're talking about productions that do have the budget to be able to support that kind of model in their edit teams. But obviously there's also the independent world, which operates very differently, where producers are struggling to just even get, you know, a budget to actually have, like, you know, a real post-production schedule. So we know that, you know, something like the model that we are pushing for bigger budget films, you know, might not be able to be done, to be practiced in independent productions. But we also need to engage with, you know, who is supporting those productions to talk about, you know, how some independent projects are getting, you know, are getting into this kind of like death wheel of having to edit samples all the time, you know, for different grants. And the young editors, sometimes, you know, they hire emerging editors to do that work. They're learning how to edit trailers, but they're not learning how to edit the films. And how do we support, you know, those emerging voices to set them up for success, for those films to be successful, right? How do we support them? How does the nonprofit world support that kind of mentorship model, so that they can also, you know, learn and make those films great? So that's something that, you know, we'd love to also engage with foundations and you know, the DPA and independent production producers landscape.
Great, thank you for that. I wanted to just
echo both Kristi and Carla and say that, you know, we're here today, we're talking specifically about this associate editor position that we're trying to create and showing you an example of how we're doing it and a database. But our situation is a microcosm of society. And in the last year, you know, for those of us who are unaware in society or didn't look at the problems, they've become so glaringly obvious that everyone's now sort of waking up. And everyone's talking about how can we change all of these things in society that are structurally flawed. And so we, each of us, have to go back to our little realm, and we have to think of it as a microcosm of the whole situation. And so if we can create something here and all change, you know, change doesn't happen overnight. It takes a lot of work, takes a lot of effort. You have to do it day after day. You have to be there for the times when you're tired, the times when you're having fun, the times when you're not having fun. It's all part of it, just like work. So, you know, if we take that and apply it to our little realm, that can have a ripple effect in society. And so I want to echo this, not just for the editors to speak up and say, hey, can I do this? Or the producers or the network execs, but also the foundations. Like, everybody has to think in a different way and think about how their small bit can make a big difference, taken cumulatively across the board.
And not just while it's a movement, right? So if we look at Time's Up Me Too, we see that there was all of this investment in that movement and hiring women and greenlighting projects. And then 9 months later, it was the levels of hiring and greenlighting projects of women was lower than the year before. And so while I'm super encouraged that we see that a lot of the foundations and the streamers and the production companies and, you know, seem to be vested in this work to try to create and move us towards a more anti-racist society and to create inclusion, and we're getting a buy-in, we also have to make sure that it's beyond this time when we're seeing the BLM movement getting buy-in, when we're seeing that, you know, there is legislation to stop anti-Asian hate. We need to make sure that we all do our parts to make sure that this is not a trend, right? And that even when it's no longer in the news, when we're not all in our homes watching so closely because of lockdown, that we are still working towards doing this work, because the buy-in on this database is not just enough. The buy-in to start in this time to increase, to support initiatives like this is not just enough. The buy-in to greenlight projects in this time for made by BIPOC people is not enough. We have to make sure that, as Faisal was saying, that this is sustainable and that this is actually going to be part of our DNA in the industry.
Thank you for that. We have a ton of really wonderful questions coming in from the audience here. So I actually want to start the audience Q&A at this point now. They're piling up here. What we're gonna do is here, we're not gonna bring people up on screen necessarily. So what we're gonna do is I'm gonna read out the question and then anybody on the panel who wants to jump in and talk. So I wanna be able to kind of get through these and get through as many of your questions as possible here. And this is something that I find really interesting here. Mabel Valdivizio asks, how do you define the associate editor role? I think that's really important to understand in this too.
Do you want, Carla?
Sure. It's a creative role. You are working with the director, making selects and rough cuts of segments for the film. You are cutting some scenes, and you have the ability to, you know, present those scenes to the editor. Usually at first, that's the kind of feedback that you get first from the editor, and then present the work to the production team and to the director. So it is, you know, I think that there is so much to be learned from the process of getting feedback, of getting, you know, maybe, you know, getting shaken by like really strong feedback. And that's something that is a beautiful thing that like I've experienced. Like sometimes my associate, most of the times, all of the time, my associate editors become the first eyes that also see my work, and I get feedback from them. And they are learning from giving feedback from the conversation about like, okay, what does this scene, you know, what is that scene doing for us for this big chunk of the film? So that's what an associate editor does. They might do some technical stuff, but, you know, hopefully if we have the buy-in from the streamers, there will also be an assistant editor. The way that we see it is that we're hoping that, you know, the lead editor is mentoring the associate editor, but that the associate editor is also mentoring the assistant editor, and that the assistant editor also gets to, you know, be part of the creative process, you know, besides the technical work that they're doing and that support that they're doing, that they're also brought into some of the creative process. So yeah, that's how I would define it. Anybody else, Faisal?
I mean, I will just add that the way I think about it is that the associate is truly the apprentice to the editor, learning the craft, learning all of the things I mentioned before, but ideally functions the same way for the assistant. So, you know, it's sort of a chain through which you're passing knowledge, you're passing skills, you're passing discoveries that have come along the way with different projects, and ideally passing on the training to help the next person down below you learn and grow and step up and make this space more inclusive.
Yeah, my first job out of film school, I mean, I had the privilege of going to film school, so there was a lot of learning there. But my first job was with an experienced editor, and the most valuable moments was sitting with her, you know, like in a couch like that, and having index cards all over the floor, and having that conversation of, okay, if we're setting something up in the story at this point, how are we going to build up to a reveal, or how are we going to build up to a climax of that narrative arc? So that when I went and helped editing scenes, I understood that big picture. That's what we were trying to do. Obviously that changed through the process. Like, you know, our first rough cut was not working, but it was through those conversations that armed me to go into those scenes and be set up for success. You know, I ended up getting a second editor's second editor credit. I have no idea what that means right now. I don't think that credit exists anymore. But that was, to me, that was the, you know, understanding of how to tame the big, you know, kind of beast that a long, you know, feature length film is about. And that's the type of learning that just sets you up for success.
And this isn't exactly answering the question, but, I think that also just highlighting that, like, this associate editor role is again, contributing and elevating the work, because, like, if you're, you know, sending an email to this AE, which, by the way, an assistant editor is a really important role, but, like, to, you know, cut this scene, or, you know, and they're in a vacuum, you know, which Carla was saying she wasn't, you're going to get A. If they're part of the conversations and they understand, they might see, like, this emotional moment in one of the shots that, like, actually wasn't the shot that they were told to look for. They might, and like Alisa mentioned from the very beginning, just, like, break this shit up. You know, like, figure out something that someone else was trying to figure out that they weren't assigned to solve, but they solved it while they were looking for these things. So just pointing out again, just like in the, like, this is about equity and it's also about the work, and both things benefit when we really consider this role fully.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
One thing I wanted to add, I love that everybody's talking about creating a more robust ecosystem of, like, mentorship from the associate to the assistant, because actually a lot of the jobs me and other experienced AEs get hired for is, like, cleaning up the kind of workflow kind of messes an inexperienced AE does. So I think that is really unfortunate, because I think it's impossible to learn workflow without hands-on experience. And I really hate the idea that people are set up to fail in that way, because I think what happens as a result of that is, like, I mean, I think getting in on the ground floor is already extremely difficult, especially for BIPOC people. And then they become kind of quietly blacklisted from ever getting another AE gig. And I think that's a real problem that's happening.
Go ahead.
And I was just saying that, like, I've AE'd for 10 years and, you know, I would love to pass this, this entire decade of knowledge that I've accrued over a lot of hard work and make it easier for the next person.
Yeah, no, that actually, there's someone who asked, I think, a question that actually really applies to what you're talking about here. And I really appreciate this question coming. It's a really important discussion. There, Aaron Cutler is asking, are discussions being had about breaking down barriers to entry for individuals who may not have the resources to get even the required equipment and programs like Avid, Premiere, to even begin to learn how to do AE work? Like, what are the resources? What can we do? And I also want to mention too that, Carla, the BIPOC editor database is not, to sign up, you don't have to have a film credit yet either. So there's already a part of that, if you all want to kind of speak to that. I think it's incredibly important to even figure out how people are entering this industry and who can because of resources. Yeah.
Part of our guidelines, we ask and urge producers, production companies, not to have unpaid internships. I mean, that's, you know, that's a way to limit access to people that can afford to have unpaid internships. And, you know, I mean, we need to ask production companies also to be aware of the costs. You know, there are people that have a really hard time like affording the $26, $30 for premiere. But you know, sometimes in our industry, we expect for the editor, for the assistant editor to like come with the equipment, come with the, you know, with all the memberships to, you know, the whole Adobe thing so they can do Photoshop. So just, you know, I mean, again, it's that engagement with the production companies to for them to also be aware of those things. Like ask your assistant editor when you're interviewing, what are your goals? Like, what do you want to do? Like just having that base information at the beginning and opening up the lines of communication, it will help your assistant editor like feel confident enough to advocate for themselves and to, you know, to try to participate more fully into the process. You know, productions can have like a later conversation where they can revisit credits, like when they see that, you know, I mean, Alisa, obviously you guys did that with your assistant, right? Please have that conversation. It has to come from you. A lot of the credit, you know, reconsiderations happen because an editor is advocating for their assistant or their assistant itself is advocating for themselves. You know, we hope that production companies are aware of it and they initiate that conversation as well. And yeah, I mean, I think that we also have to look at what mentorship is like and the networking that you create in the room. Like, you know, is there situations where white creatives are jumping up much faster than BIPOC creatives? Like, you know, can we just look at ourselves and like, what are our tendencies of who we befriend in the production team? Who do we take out to lunch? Who do we like start talking to? Because maybe they're a reflection of ourselves. So everything has to be intentional. Again, you know, going back to that speech from Lewis, it's like, you gotta check your privilege. You gotta check it often. You know, you have to be aware and be conscious about your intentions of creating more equity.
Thank you for saying that, Carla. I wanna shout out David Teague, who brought it to my attention, you know, about the credit. You know, I think oftentimes a producer and even the production company, there's so much happening that you're not really aware. I think for me, I always think about getting production assistants and trying to get as many of them as possible, because that's like, for me, that's how I came in. That was the entry level position that I was paid to do. I always tell my kids I made $282.17 100 years ago, every 2 weeks. And even back then, that wasn't a lot to survive on, but it was the entry into the industry. And so I always think about, in addition to internships, production assistant positions are really also good places to start and to have those conversations and for producers and others to mentor these people that are just breaking in to say what it is that you want to do. And yeah, I echo all that you said. We have to be intentional and put our money where our mouth is. I think we often can get a production assistant paid, but not necessarily maybe the intern, but that's another way to get that person on the ground level, you know, paid and included in a way that we can then start to mentor them. And we're putting a lot of emphasis on the editors to mentor, but we all have a responsibility to mentor. So it's, you know, I remember on my last film, I was hearing a lot about Alisa, you're just teaching a lot of people on the job. And I was like, yeah, you know, that's part of, like you said, Carla, earlier, that's my part of my responsibility as someone in this position to help people to get to the next level. So it's not only editors, it's everybody in every position that has to mentor the next generation of great storytellers.
Thank you for that. This is something we've been, I think, touching on throughout the panel, but I'm curious about this question here. Ryan asks, a lot of good AEs get pigeonholed because they have a very technical job without a good mentor. How can an AE position themselves to make the transition to be more of an editor? And as a person of color, it's hard to speak up and advocate for themselves. Can you all talk about that experience? I think that's a kind of and the next level of what we're talking about beyond the just the technical job of an AE, it's about being in the room.
I mean, I'll say from, you know, my perspective, the advice that I would give is it's hard to learn to speak up, and especially if you're a person of color, especially if you're a woman, especially if you're starting out. And, you know, that is a skill you have to develop, like, regardless. And so, you know, sometimes we have to push ourselves to go out of our comfort zone and take that difficult little step that feels so huge. So, you know, my advice is to just try to keep bringing up the fact that, hey, you've got all the tech skills mastered and you've delivered everything they want whenever they wanted. You're anticipating what the editor's needs are and the producer's needs. And, but I want to be a storyteller. I want to cut. How can you give me a scene? So sometimes it's got to come about through impressing the people you're working with and then saying, I've gone above and beyond, and that, like, give me more. And I know that's really hard because the hours are long, there's a lot of tech stuff, but because we don't have the pipeline that we're all talking about, which would solve this problem, part of it is now that individuals have to fight for themselves out in the world, which, like, we all have had to do in our careers at different times. So that's like my little piece of advice, but I think Hannah maybe has something to share on this.
Yeah, although I have to admit, it's hard for me to answer because I've been in this position for 10 years, so it's clearly been a struggle for me. But I think one thing that's helped in my relationship with Faisal and Kristi and Netsana is that we actually worked together over the course of a year. So if you are able to, I mean, one, it was because they intentionally created this for me, but then also I think I developed a really organic, authentic relationship with them as people, not just as coworkers and whatnot. And I think that that actually laid a really great foundation for the work that Faisal and I are doing together now in the edit room. Because I think, I mean, I've struggled a lot with self-advocacy. It's taken me years of practice. I mean, even through the process of this, I've had to really learn how to speak up. And but yeah, again, I guess it is about trying to find people you feel safe with, because I think, like, the people that have nurtured my growth have really been instrumental and critical in my growth too. But yeah, that's a tough one, but.
I was gonna say that too, find an ally, whatever that means. You know, as a Black woman, as a producer who has had some mild success, I still have to curate how I say things. While I am on this call, I am watching my face. Not because I'm actively watching my face, because I've been told before that sometimes when I am concentrating, I look like an angry Black woman, and I'm like, me, what, right? But these are the things that we sometimes, as BIPOC people, and I want to say this to be honest in the space, right, that we have to deal with. So I understand that it's not that easy to advocate for yourself. I have a different type of personality, so those things don't bother me as much, but it's really difficult sometimes because you don't want to seem like an agitator. You don't want to, oftentimes as women, if you speak up, you're difficult, and you get that label. So I understand how difficult it is to speak up for yourself as a person of color, but Hannah makes the really good point that I wanted to make, that you find those allies in whoever it is. You have whatever relationship it is with that person, and you find the person that you feel that you could tell, and maybe that can help you get your messaging across and help you craft the message and also be heard. Because it's not always just as simple as advocating for yourself, because again, there are all these barriers sometimes to just getting treated fairly that should not exist, unfortunately, but they do.
I would just add to that. Right. So there's like you're angry, you're difficult, or you're entitled, right? Could be the ways that you're described as a I guess non-white man trying to move. And it's like, it's really about like, so the onus is on producers, right? To create a space. We talked about intentionality and culture, right? So that's on some of us. And then also to the person who asked the advice, yeah, it's about like seeking out, is there a way, like, I know that right now we're in a semi-remote world, like, is there a way you can get on a Zoom? And, you know, like, I think that just like chatting, you know, like, is a really important thing for humans to do with one another, to get to know each other and connect with them. And it's more, you know, who might be different from them. And that's a little bit harder because you get on the Zoom and you're like, all right, we got 30 minutes. We got to work through these notes. So maybe just if that is the environment, then maybe say like, do you have 20 minutes where we could talk? And so that you can start to like build that foundation with some people in your life who can also give you the confidence to advocate or advocate on your behalf when possible.
Yeah, sorry, I'm just gonna add one more quick thing. I think building a community of people who are also peers is really important. I didn't have that in the Bay Area, so I didn't know anyone else in my position. But coming out here, like I've been connected with so many great people who have actually helped connect me to gigs, but then also just for the support. I had an editor jokingly refer to it as a trauma support group, but I think people who will also, you could vent to, that will validate your concerns and that will also help build you up, and that you could come up together. I think that's super important. But, and there's luckily a lot of great organizations in New York and yeah, I can't speak to those cities, but I think like a lot of these things have been really helpful in my career.
Yeah. Thank you, Hannah. And we are out of time. I just want to wrap it up and just say really quickly that this is an incredible conversation, and I hope these conversations will ripple out and continue in edit rooms, in production meetings, in executive meetings, all across our industry as well. So I want to send it over to Maggie really quick to wrap up. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Thank you so much to the panelists for sharing your insights here. The chat has been blowing up. There are so many wonderful questions. I want to thank everyone in the audience for being here and for your really thoughtful questions. We could clearly continue to have more and more conversations about this. The event will be on our YouTube page in a few days. So please feel free to share that recording to the people you think may have missed it, that would have enjoyed it, to executives, streamers, production companies out there that you think could really use this. And we'll also be sending you some links and a survey if you wouldn't mind sharing about your experience. I want to thank our wonderful ASL interpreters, Mara Bassani Santa Maria and Sharon Pierre-Louis, and our captioner, Tina Dillon. And huge thanks to my IDA colleagues behind the scenes, Cassidy Diamond, Nikki Bardwaj, Leanne Scrimmager, Susan Yin, and all of the other staff at IDA. Thank you. Thank you so much to everyone. Have a good day.
Have a great day, all. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Full frame.
There is a launch. Carla, jump in.
There's a launch event for our database at Full Frame. It's going to be a celebration of our talent, like say normalize our talent, and you'll see our faces and the beautiful films that we've created. So come, everybody, please.
Thank you.